Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to all of you in the name of our Savior Jesus. It's a special day in the church year today. Actually, it's the last day of the church year today. It's the day that we always celebrate Christ the King Sunday. Today we're going to do that in a little bit of a special way. Christ is King in eternity, in past and present and future, throughout every season of the church year. And today we're going to focus on that fact. So there's seven seasons of the church year that we focus on. Advent and Christmas and Epiphany and Lent and Easter and Pentecost and end time. We're going to remember and focus on the idea that Christ is King throughout it all. And in each of those seasons, we're going to see a reading and we're going to sing a hymn that's going to focus on that idea that Christ is our King, the King who loves us and saves us and has a heavenly kingdom that he is preparing for us even right now. So hopefully you picked up a service folder on your way in. It tells you that our opening hymn for today is hymn number 341, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Let's sing that together after we take a few moments for silent prayer and meditation to prepare our hearts for worship. God's blessings. Please stand. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the peoples of the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. Therefore rejoice, you heavens and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, by your victory, you have broken the power of the evil one. Fill our hearts with joy and peace as we look with hope to that day when every creature in heaven and on earth will acclaim you King of kings and Lord of lords to your unending praise and glory. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The congregation may be seated. I invite the children to come forward at this time for the children's sermon.
Morning, kids. Glad to see you. Thanks for coming up here. Today, we're talking about how Jesus is a king, right? I want to go back to when I was a little boy. When I was a little boy, we had things called Lutheran Schools Week or Spirit Week, and one of my favorite things was dressing up. We got to dress up as different things, and one of my favorite dress-up days was Hat Day. Teachers and students alike would get to dress up in all kinds of crazy different hats. Big hats, little hats, silly hats. But everyone got to wear a hat all day long, right? You can't do that on a normal school day. So, you can tell a lot about a person maybe by the hat they wear. Maybe what their favorite team is, or, you know, what their favorite kind of seat is. Or, you know, you can also tell a lot about their job. So I have a couple hats here. So here's one hat. You can maybe tell me, who would wear a hat like this?
Builder.
Yeah, builder, all right? Construction workers is kind of a, this is a hard hat, right? You want to wear that for me? All right. You got another hat here? I think you might know this one.
Fireman!
That's right. You guys are good at this, aren't you? Okay, you can wear this one. All right, now I have a different kind of hat here. First of all, what kind of hat is this?
A king.
This is a
crown.
And you got it. A king or a queen would wear a crown. A crown, right? Yeah. And this kind of crown, you know, has jewels and all kinds of fancy stuff. It's made out of gold. Now, today we're talking about a king. Yeah, you can wear that. Say please. Yeah, here you go. All right. Does it fit? Perfect. Meant to be. So today in church, we're talking about a different kind of king, though. This king was born a long, long time ago. This king did not live in a palace, and he didn't have his own kingdom here on this earth. His kingdom was not of this world. And so I think you know who I'm talking about. Who am I talking about? Jesus. Yeah. That's right. Jesus had a kingdom in heaven. That's right. Triune God. We believe in that unity there. So, Jesus did wear a crown, but not a crown made of gold or jewels. It was a different kind of crown that actually hurt him.
Yeah, it was a form.
Yeah, it was a what?
It was one of those spiky crowns.
A crown of thorns. And he didn't put it on willingly. Some soldiers made it out of some really, really painful thorns, and then they smashed it on his head, pushed it down, and then they beat him in the head. Do you think that felt good?
No.
No. Jesus suffered, and he died for you and for me. He died on the cross so that someday we can be with him forever in heaven. Jesus did not come to be a king of armies or countries. He came to be the king of our hearts and our lives. So boys and girls, we have the most wonderful kind of king. We have the best kind of king. A kind of king who is Jesus, and he is the king who gives us forgiveness.
Yes, and he's actually God's son.
You got it. You keep telling people that, okay? You're good at that. All right? He gives us three things, and the best one is the best of all. We'll save it for last. He gives us forgiveness, he gives us love, and he gives us eternal life so that we can be in God's kingdom forever in heaven. Got it? Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for being the kind of king who doesn't want gold and power and treasure, but rather a king who loved us so, so much that you came to this earth to live and die for us. Thank you, Christ, who is our King, for going to the cross for each one of us, to wash away our sins. And thank you for the home you are preparing for us in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for coming up here, guys. I'll take the hats. You know what? You keep the hat. Keep it.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Thank you, kids, for coming up. The first season of the church year is Advent. It's the one that's going to begin just a week from now. That word Advent means coming. And for 4 weeks each year, God's people prepare for Christ's coming at Christmas by repenting of their sins, but also looking forward with eager anticipation to our deliverance. And how did God deliver us from our sins? He delivered us by becoming human to save us. Through the miracle of the virgin birth, through Jesus being conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, the Son of God came to earth to live and die and rise again, and all of it for us, for our sake, in our place. The season of Advent is about humbly yet joyfully preparing our hearts for the King who for us and for our salvation came once in lowliness and is surely coming again one day in glory. Our Advent lesson comes from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 through 35. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." This is the word of our Lord. Let's continue with hymn number 4. We'll sing verses 1 through 3 of "Lift Up Your Heads, You Mighty Gates." The season of Advent culminates in our celebration of the Savior's birth at Christmas. That is just a word that means the day of Christ's Mass, the day when God's church gathers together to celebrate the festival that Christ the Savior is born. But let's not just think about a cute little baby in a manger here. Let's remember most of all that this baby had a job to do of ruling the world on his shoulders with truth and justice and peace and righteousness. The God of all the universe allowed himself to be placed in a manger in Bethlehem so that one day everyone would know him as the Prince of Peace and as the true, almighty, eternal King. Our Christmas lesson comes from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. This is the word of our Lord. Our next hymn is hymn number 62. We'll sing verses 1 and 4 of Joy to the World. Twelve days after Christmas begins the next season of the church year, Epiphany. Epiphany is a word that means appearing or revealing, and in this season of the church year, we see Jesus begin to reveal who he really is to this world. He does that by his preaching, by his miracles, and by the divine love that he shows that could only possibly come from the Savior so long promised. Here in this reading, we see three wise men from the east helping with this process. They come to baby Jesus and they worship him. That's something that is only the true God is really worthy of. They bring him gifts that are fit for the greatest king of all. And that all teaches us the all-important truth that Jesus is the Savior King, not just of the Jews, but of the whole world. And he spent the rest of his life proving it. So today, let's take a lesson from these magi and let's worship Christ our King together. Our Epiphany lesson comes from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 and 9 through 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. This is the word of our Lord. Let's sing together hymn number 83. We'll sing verses 1 through 3 and 5 of As With Gladness Men of Old. Please stand. Let's confess together now our common Christian faith using the Apostles' Creed. It's printed for you on the bottom of page 6 in your service folder. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let's continue now by bringing our thank offerings to our Lord. I'd ask that while the offering is being collected, please sign the friendship registers that are located at the ends of your pews and tear out the sheets and put them on top of the booklets when you're done. Also, during the offering, we will be watching this month's edition of the Wells Connection. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. Our work in Africa is entering an exciting new phase. As the national churches there mature and communication technologies improve, God is giving us new opportunities that we couldn't have imagined only a few years ago.
Our Synod's first mission trip to Africa 70 years ago is almost impossible to imagine today. Roads were treacherous, supplies were hard to get, and if something went wrong, there was no one to call, because even landline phones did not exist there.
That adventurous spirit and willingness for the sake of the gospel. They pointed people to Christ, they pointed people to the scriptures, and we're building on that.
Over the decades, the church has grown exponentially, with national leaders emerging and an educational system in place to train African pastors.
You have to be eager to work, isn't it?
This blessing has allowed our Wells missionaries to transition to new roles. One result is the creation of the One Africa Team, which facilitates our missionaries helping emerging Christian groups all over the continent. The One Africa Team is mobilized to bring Christ-centered, Bible-based guidance wherever there is need.
And they're calling for us everywhere. Ghana, Uganda, Kenya, Somalia, Sudan, Liberia, all over, West Africa, East Africa, South Africa, everywhere. They're calling and they're saying, we want the truth of Scripture.
They're looking for any partners out there that still teach what the Bible teaches. And it's not that surprising that God would lead them to us. But because of that, we have leads popping up in a dozen new African countries.
The result is that our missionaries spend more time on the road as they bring God's word to fledgling Christian groups who need encouragement and basic instruction.
A lot of travel for our missionaries, a lot of tough work going into new places, but we're expanding beyond just those few places that we had started with so many years ago.
Of course, every African country is unique, and our missionaries must customize the approach to meet local needs. The One Africa Team gives us a better platform to connect in these new regions.
Seeing that eureka of the gospel in African eyes that I've seen so many times, that's what I really am excited to spread through our national partners to new places.
In a land where fresh water and food are still not always available, it's refreshing to see that, for many Africans, their biggest hunger and thirst is for the true gospel message, a saving, satisfying message we work to supply every day.
A few examples of the opportunities the One Africa Team is addressing. In Liberia, a 5,000-member church body has requested training, and our missionaries have been offering instruction there, which we pray will lead to church fellowship in the future. In Mozambique, the team is partnering with national pastors to set up a church to serve the growing number of Lutherans there, now numbering nearly 1,000. In Uganda, just recently, a group of 700 Christians has asked for training, and there are a dozen more. The One Africa Team is a valuable platform for connecting to the growing opportunities in Africa. We praise our Savior and thank you for helping us support their efforts.
The season of Lent comes when the spring days begin to lengthen. And that's what that old English word Lent means, is lengthen. It's intended to reflect that the light of the world came to shine through the darkness of sin and death. But the way he did that was by bearing sin and suffering death for us. The season of Lent begins on Ash Wednesday, that day when Christians put ashes on their foreheads to help them remember that because of their sins, dust we are and to dust we will return. This is a season of solemn reflection and repentance as we watch our innocent Savior arrested and crucified because of sins we committed. But through it all, Christ remains our true King, a King who was clothed in purple as royalty really deserves, even though those soldiers only meant it in mockery. A King who wore a crown of thorns, and a King who held not a ruler's scepter, but instead a criminal's cross, so that one day we could live with him in his heavenly kingdom forever. Our Lent reading, our Lent lesson, comes from John chapters 18 and 19, selected verses there. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews? Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." It was the day of preparation of Passover week, about the sixth hour. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away! Take him away! Crucify him!" "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." This is the word of our Lord. Our next hymn is hymn number 110. We'll sing verses 1 through 3 and 7 of "My Song is Love Unknown." Thank you. after the solemn remembrance of Jesus' suffering and death, the church breaks forth with joy on Easter morning as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. And you remember how that famous greeting goes, don't you? I say, Christ is risen. Pretty good for being put on the spot. Thank you. The resurrection of our Lord is the highest festival of the Christian church year because on Easter Sunday, Christ our King rose victorious from the grave to prove that our sins are forever forgiven, that he really is the Son of God and the Savior so long promised, and so our faith really is well founded. And that he will one day destroy all our spiritual enemies and deliver eternal resurrection life to us and all his people as well. Our Easter lesson comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 17 through 26. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all men. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in his own turn, Christ the first fruits, then when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. This is the word of our Lord. Let's continue with hymn number 157. We'll sing verses 1 through 3 of Jesus Christ is Risen Today. Please stand for the prayer of the church. A responsive prayer of the church begins on the bottom of page 8 in your service folder. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. You are worthy, O Christ our King, to receive honor and glory and praise, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. You are worthy, O Christ our King, to receive honor and glory and praise, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased us for God. From every tribe and language and people and nation, you have called us into your kingdom and have made us priests to serve you, our God and Father. We give thanks to you, O Christ, our Shepherd King, because you have searched for us and found us. Lead us to the green pastures and quiet waters of your saving love, so that we may enjoy peace and comfort for our souls. We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. Come with your mighty power to break and defeat every evil plan and purpose of the devil, of the ungodly influences and ideas of the world, and of our own sinful nature. Use your power to calm the unrest among nations and peoples, so that your kingdom may spread and grow. O Christ, our King, you have supremacy over all. You will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. You have destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Reign in our hearts that we may serve you more faithfully and speak more boldly to others of your saving love. Lord, we ask you today to please also guide and bless my deliberations as I've been called to serve Good Shepherd Lutheran Church in Beaver Dam, Wisconsin. Give me and my family wisdom and willingness to serve you wherever is best. Give your people here in Norfolk and there in Beaver Dam a spirit of humble encouragement and contentment, and open my mind and heart to see where I can be of greatest benefit for my family and for your kingdom. Lord, we also bring thanks today on behalf of Ruth Eaker, who celebrated her 101st birthday yesterday. We thank you for giving her so many years of serving and honoring you, and we ask you in all the time you still grant to her in this world, keep her close to you, strengthen her faith in you, and finally bring her home to your heavenly kingdom. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Look, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever, King of kings and Lord of lords. Amen. We join in the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The congregation may be seated. We'll continue now with our adult choir anthem, How Majestic Is Your Name.
Thank you.
Thank you, friends. Pentecost, the name Pentecost, it simply means 50. Because 50 days after Easter, another history-changing event happened in the life of the church. The Holy Spirit came upon God's people to give them the gifts they needed in order to carry out Jesus' great commission and take the gospel message of forgiveness and life and salvation by faith to the ends of the earth. Because of that, we remember Pentecost as the birthday of the Christian church, the day when the gospel message of our Savior King Jesus first went out into the world and eventually came to us. And so we spend the whole rest of the summer and fall remembering and celebrating that the King who died for us now wants us to live for Him and grow in faith in Him until the day when He brings us to live with Him in His heavenly kingdom forever. Our Pentecost lesson comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know Him better. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which He has called you, the riches of His glorious inheritance in the saints, and His incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is like the working of His mighty strength, which He exerted in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and seated Him at His right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every title that can be given, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under His feet and appointed Him to be head over everything for the church, which is His body, the fullness of Him who fills everything in every way. This is the word of our Lord. Let's continue now with hymn number 175. We'll sing verses 1 through 3 and 5 and 6 of Hail the Day That Sees Him Rise. Finally, we have come to the last season of the church year. It's the season that we are in right now. It's the season that we call end time. This is the time of the year when we look forward to the end of the world and eternity. This end time season is a season that can be pretty unsettling for a lot of people because there is so much that is unknown and even scary about the Bible's picture of the future. But the ultimate point of it all is that just as our King Jesus came once to save us, so also he is surely coming again one day to win the final victory for us as well. And just like a truly strong and loving father always does for his children, he will stop at nothing to fight for his people, to deliver us from all the forces of evil in this world, and to finally bring us home to the glories of his heavenly kingdom. Our end times lesson comes from Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16 and 19 and 20. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has this name written: King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against the rider on the horse and his army. But the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who had performed the miraculous signs on his behalf. With these signs he had deluded those who had received the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the word of our Lord. Let's continue now with our next hymn. It's hymn number 731, The King Will Come at Age's End. You can find that printed on page 13 in your service folder. Please stand for the closing prayer. Blessed Lord, you have given us your holy scriptures for our learning. May we so hear them, read, learn, and take them to heart, that being strengthened and comforted by your holy word, we may cling to the blessed hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our King, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated for the closing hymn. We'll sing together hymn number 579, Lift High the Cross.